Persevere. What does it mean to persevere? We've been talking about this with the guys throughout this week. To persevere. The definition for the word persevere is to keep going when things get tough. Now, there are two things that this definition implies. One, that things are going to get tough. Anybody here attest to that one? And two, that it's good to keep going. Who in this life do we recognize, do we honor, do we respect and look up to, except those who keep going? Those who never quit. Those who persevere. You see, Jesus in John chapter 16, verse 33 said, he said, "Here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I have overcome the world." And that's what we just saw right there. Nothing could hold him down. Nothing could make him stop. As she was saying, in our nature, we are inclined to stop, to quit, to give up. But if Jesus was who he said he was, there existed in him no ability to quit. He was going to persevere. You see, it basically goes like this. Jesus right here has told us, here on earth you will have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I've overcome the world. Imagine God speaking to Jesus and saying, "Jesus, I got some truth, I got some good news, and I got some results. The truth is, all those people down there, they're lost, they're hopeless, unless you go and you give your life for them. So the truth is, I need you to go and you give your life for them. And it's going to be hard. It's not going to be an easy price to pay. But there's good news. I'm with you. We got this." The result, should you choose to accept your mission, every single one of them down there has the opportunity to be saved. Every single one of them has a chance for eternity. He said, "Jesus, if you will persevere, if you will go through this, every single one of them can be saved." And Jesus says the same to us. He says, "I got some truth, I got some good news, and I got some results." Truth is, in this life, you will have trials and sorrows. Does anybody doubt that? You see, I think we do. I think that the enemy convinces us to doubt that, to hope each day, maybe I won't have trials and sorrows today. Maybe today will be easy. And of course, this is in our nature. Nobody gets out of bed and says, "Boy, I hope today sucks. Boy, I hope I spill a coffee on myself. I hope the car won't start. I hope my wife gets mad at me." Nobody does that, right? Because it's in our nature to desire joy, to desire peace, because that's who God created us to be. You see, those are the fruits of the Spirit, joy, peace. That's who he is, and if he created us in his identity, it's in our nature to desire joy and peace. Now, here's where the trick happens. Here's where we get tripped up. Satan says, you want joy and peace? It's by quitting. This is too difficult. You don't have to go through this. You don't deserve to have to go through this. Just quit. It can be easy. You can have the joy, the peace that you seek. Just give up. Just walk away. Marriage, you don't have to persevere through this. Marriage is supposed to be easy. That's what's in the movies, right? The enemy is always trying to convince us, you don't have to persevere. You should have it easy. You should be able to get away with just doing as little as possible in life, right? That's the American dream, right? The just constant leisure and freedom, and I'm just going to go on vacation for the rest of my life. I can't think of anything worse. Ask Jamie. I last about 2 hours. And I'm like, okay, when are we going back? But Satan is constantly trying to convince us that we should have it easy. I think that's our first problem with perseverance, is this false hope that things will be easy. But Jesus, our creator, the one who spoke and created this, the planet, everything, just spoke and said, in this life you will have trials and sorrows. So is there any more doubt about that? You will have trials and sorrows. You We've been convinced by the enemy that we should have it easy. And for me anyways, I don't know about you, but I kind of tend to think like maybe I can like play it safe. Like maybe I can circumvent the trials and sorrows. Like if I tiptoe through life, right, then he won't see me out there. The trials and sorrows won't catch up to me and I can get away with an easy life, right? But God calls that the lukewarm Christian, right? Just easing my way through life, not really taking any risks, not really sticking my neck out there, not doing anything that might bring trial or sorrow. That's a lukewarm Christian. You see, I think that we exist too much on this side of the spectrum of the, I hope I don't deal with the trials and sorrows today. I hope it's not so bad today. But Christians over here on this side, as followers of Christ, the one who overcame death, death couldn't hold him down. We exist on this side of the spectrum. Bring it. I don't care what you bring. Nothing can hold me down. Death couldn't hold him down. And he lives in me. You see, that's who Jesus is. He says, if you will let me, I will give you my Holy Spirit, and there's nothing that can stop you. Amen. Christians persevere. Quit is not in our language. We don't have the ability to quit. If we are who we are, who we say we are, and if Christ was who he said he was, and he didn't have the ability to quit, if he lives in us, we do not have the ability to quit. We persevere. We face the fact that we will have trials and sorrows. Life is not going to be easy, guys. Now that brings the question, why? Why trials and sorrows? You hear this one all the time. If God loves me, then how come that happened? Or how come the trials and sorrows? How come I have to go through this? Two reasons that I could come up with. One, it's strengthening our faith. In 1 Peter 1:7, actually, let's go there. Turn in your Bibles there with me to 1 Peter 1:7. Why trials? Why sorrows? Why, since I received Christ, isn't this life just rainbows and butterflies? I thought that's what it was going to be. I thought I would just get out of that tank and then just, you know, just count the rainbows and the sheep all day. But in 1 Peter 1:7, it says, these trials will show that your faith is genuine. It is being tested as fire tests and purifies gold. Though your faith is far more precious than mere gold, so when your faith remains strong through many trials, it will bring you much praise and glory and honor on the day when Jesus Christ is revealed to the whole world. You see, what's happening with these trials and sorrows is we're being shown just how desperately we need Christ. Remember on day six when when Satan came to Adam and Eve and said, "Surely you won't die. Surely you can do things your own way and things will be all right," right? And he's doing the same thing to us. Surely you should have it easy. Surely you shouldn't have to go through these trials and sorrows. And what it turns into is us claiming this independence, this lack of need for God. You see, God created us. He loves us. He knows exactly what we need. He knows exactly how and when to give it to us. And he's trying to get us to trust in him for that, to remove our autonomy and our independence from God. It's like trying to tell a smoker, like trying to convince them desperately, dude, you need fresh air to breathe. Like, should that take much convincing? No, your lungs, that's how they're made. They're made to breathe oxygen, clean, fresh oxygen. And this is the same thing that God's doing with us. He's like, dude, you need me. I gave you your breath. I gave you every bit of who you are. You need me. And that's what the trials and sorrows are doing. They're removing our false idea of independence. I got this. I don't need God. The other thing that the trials and sorrows do is they show the rest of the world, the non-believers, man, he really does have this. He really can overcome. There really is nothing that can hold him down. when the world sees a Christian going through struggles in marriage, but getting to the other side, they say, man, everybody else quits. Everybody else, as soon as it gets tough, they just give up. Why should I keep going? There's a thousand other out there. But they see the Christians and they say that maybe there is some truth to this God thing. Maybe I truly do need God. I'm not going to drag this out in perseverance. In fact, I bought a friend who is the absolute model for perseverance, if I've ever heard of it or seen one. And so I want you guys to meet my buddy Matt Manzari. Matt and I have been friends since, you were 13, I was 16, I guess, 14, yeah. Let's play the video, actually. Did you get the video, Mark? Yeah, excellent. Let's do that. And that'll intro Matt. And we're not asking you for money. Just listen to this, and this will show you what.
My best friend, Matt Manzari, who I grew up riding with since I was, 13 years old, was in a serious accident. He was trimming trees near a power line, and nobody knows whether the chainsaw hit the power line or it arced to the bucket or what, but he got electrocuted, and he got fourth and fifth degree burns all over his chest and his arms, and some on his ears and his legs. So he's in a pretty serious state right now. He's at ORMC, and he needs all the prayers that he can get. Although Matt Manzari's got some titles under his belt, he's Wake Stock champion, he's won the best trick award, but he's always been known as more of a creator and looked up to by so many.
When I first met Matt, he was doing tricks that people aren't even doing now. Super inspiring, and getting to wake skate with him growing up has been amazing, and he's gonna power through it. I've talked to him a few times. I hope the best for him.
As a community, wake skating needs to come together, and really the whole wake industry needs to come together and help him out and support him through this hard time, financially, emotionally, everything we can do to help.
Everybody supports him, everybody loves him. However you can help, just give it a little bit, and it's gonna be much appreciated.
There's been a couple different options on people's Instagrams, but ultimately the donations page is where Matt needs it the most. It's a YouCaring site, YouCaring.com, and then you go and you search the Manzari family. And you can go in there and donate and help him out and make sure he gets back to living the regular life with his family. Can't wait to have him back.
Good evening, everybody. It's an honor to be here. The last time I was with you guys, it wasn't in the last building, but the building before that in Tavares. So it's amazing to see how much this church family's grown and come together, and it's just incredible. And like Kyle said, I've known Kyle since I was 13 years old. He actually lived at my house for a little while, and in the summertime, because we were just hanging out every day. And he's an awesome guy, and it's just amazing because I knew Kyle BC. Some of you guys don't know Kyle BC. And it's amazing to not only see Kyle come to Christ, but to come so far that he is leading a worship band, helping build a church, and come up here and preach. It's just, I can't even tell you how much joy that brings me to just see that happen to my friend. It's amazing. So let's give Kyle a round of applause. Now, not to step on any toes here, but I have a theory that we serve an unfair God. And before you guys grab me and throw me out the front door, just hear me out, because I truly believe we serve an unfair God. And to tell you a little bit about my background, that guy talking, he's actually sitting there right there. He's a professional wake skater as well. And that's Reed. He can stand up. I can embarrass him. I started water skiing when I was 5 years old. Reed and I started wake skating all the time when we were 13 or 14, started riding professionally when we were 15. And it wasn't really something we planned on. We just loved doing it, did it every day. And before we knew it, he started riding for Fox. I started riding for Nike and Malibu and Supra and Sea-Doo, and all these companies started. And it just kind of happened. We didn't plan on it, but before we knew it, we were at a young age in a career, at that point in my life, I had never planned on doing anything else. That was, you know, my career set, and I'm going to wake skate as long as I can, as long as my knees will let me, and then be a team manager or something else in the industry. And God had other plans. When I was 17 years old, I started feeling this calling to ministry, and that's another story we can go into later. But basically, I fought it for a really long time. I didn't tell anybody about it, and you know, I didn't plan on going to college or anything. I already had a career. And finally, he made himself so abundantly clear to me. I said, I can't deny this. And my life just did a 180 at that point, and I went to school for ministry. And, you know, it's not like, we all know there's no, what is a good person, quote unquote. I mean, who have sinned? All have sinned. The wages of sin are death. So if there were good and bad people, none of us would be here. But, you know, I had a really good life up until I went to school for ministry. I never had major challenges. I never lost somebody really close to me. I never went through big tragedies. So you think when I looked back at my career, once I got to school, you know, I'm not saying this is how it is for all pro athletes, but I probably spent 99% of my thinking on how can I get more sponsors for myself? How can I bring more exposure and money and attention to myself? So when you go from that to, okay, now I'm going to school and I'm just, you know, it's like a new life. I'm just so passionate and excited to see what I could do for others and how can I help others and how can I serve God every day. When you go from living a kind of selfish life to trying to live a life for God, you kind of think in the back of your mind, bad things aren't going to happen. They haven't happened before. Why would they happen now? And, you know, I'm not trying to sound naive because I look at, okay, John the Baptist, like my role model, best dude ever. He's Jesus' cousin. He's got a lot of things he could be cocky about. He could walk around, you know, you're talking to him, Jesus' cousin. No, but he gets up there and he says, who are you? I'm just a voice. I'm just a voice. And there's one coming after me whose sandals I'm not even worthy to untie. So like the most humble dude ever, well, spoiler alert, he ends up getting beheaded. It's not very nice. The apostles, they walk with Christ. They go start, they're the reason we're here today, starting the Christian church. Some of them crucified. Some of them crucified upside down. Job, I don't know if you've ever read Job. Job is the kind of book that you're reading like, okay, I'm going to do a read through the Bible in a year. And you get through Job and the whole way you're taking notes like, oh, this verse helped me for this. And when you get to Job, you get to the end and there's no notes at all in it. And you take out your little notepad and you stick it in the front of Job and you just write, never read again. It's just 43 chapters and it's kind of depressing, especially if we look at it from kind of the wrong angles. But one thing I like about Job is this guy and God calls this council meeting of all the leaders, all the angels, and Satan has the audacity to show up. And Satan's there, and God says, what are you doing here? And Satan says, well, this is a meeting for the leaders. You know the earth? I lead the earth. Everyone there is doing my will. And God says, wait a minute. Have you met Job? Consider my servant Job. And we look at Job's life and Satan says, well, yeah, everyone's heard of Job. You give him everything he wants. He's got the best family, the best job. He's got tons of cattle. You won't let me touch him. How could you expect anything else other than praise? If you touch him, if you curse him, I guarantee he'll deny you and die. I guarantee it. And right there's a lesson we can learn in Job that God doesn't curse. You know, we talk about when we look at situations and bad things and we say, oh, God did this for a reason. No, God didn't do that. God doesn't do any of that. You know, we live in a sinful world where Satan is working and yes, God may allow it, but he didn't do it. And I think we need to be careful sometimes when we say what God did or didn't do. I could walk outside right now, stand in the building, go, check this out, guys, and jump off and break my legs. Now, did God do that for a reason? No, I jumped off the roof. But in that tragedy, in the bad things in this world, God can work. And I'm about to share a little bit about my life where through two pretty big tragedies and challenges, I just kind of lived off this verse in Genesis where Joseph is being reunited with his brothers and his brothers sold him into slavery and told his dad he's dead and all these horrible things. And they see him one day and they fall down on their knees and they're crying and they're like, I'm so sorry. How did we do this to our brother? And Joseph says, no, you meant it for evil. You meant it to harm me, but God used it for good. And that's just such, you know, I live off that verse that there's a lot of bad things in this world that are meant for evil. Satan meant it to harm us. Other people mean it to harm us. But God can work in that, and he can work in the midst of those tragedies. So I was, as I said, 17 years old, feel a calling to ministry, and I'm at school. Fast forward 4 years now, I'm about to graduate. And all the way through school, God just blessed. I thought I was going to, you know, you call your sponsor, hey, Nike, I'm going to still try to ride as much as I can, but I'm going to be at Bible college for like 10, 11 months of the year. Do you still want to pay me year round? So those conversations don't go real well, and I thought I was going to get dropped by everybody instantly, and God just blessed and allowed me to keep a lot of my sponsors all the way through school. My parents, huge blessing. They put me through school, and you know, just financially, that was just, I can't thank them enough. I'm so indebted to them. And just, I really felt like I was right in the middle of where God wanted me, and I'm excited. I was newly married. My wife is right over there, and we're about to go into full-time ministry. And I said, okay, I'm kind of out of wake skating, but the Pro Tour is only 4 weekends a year. So if I could stay in the top 10, I might as well try to ride. It's only a couple weekends. You know, it's not going to really take away from whatever I'm doing in ministry. So I'm 2 days away from graduating, and I say I'm going to go down to Florida. The first stop is in Florida. I'll qualify. I'll get back to Tennessee. I'll take my finals, and we're packing up, and we're moving to wherever God calls us, and we're all excited. And I come down to Florida. This is about 2 years ago, and as you all know, the lakes have been really low for a while, and there's a narrow spot in the pass, and it's really narrow and really shallow, and to let the boat go through so the boat wake won't erode the shoreline, they put center blocks and rebar and just kind of dump trash to keep the shoreline protected. And I end up going into the shoreline, and you know, 1 minute I'm on my wake skate, next thing I open my eyes, there's about 10 doctors around me telling me not to move, and I'm told that they have no idea why I'm alive. I've crushed the whole upper right side of my skull in 16 places. My whole eye socket collapsed. I broke my jaw clean. It's just totally loose. I had a piece of rebar go through the back of my leg. Broke my hand in 5 places. And then about a week later, this is the next memory I have. It's a really blurry week. They're telling me I'm going to surgery, and I wake up, and they say they put 16 screws in my face, a couple plates. And I always think we serve a God who's big picture. And I'm like, okay, God has a plan for salvation. As Kyle said, he promises we will go through struggles on this earth. I mean, think about it. Unless you can wrap yourself in a bubble, never drive, never go outside, and outlive everybody and everything you're close to, at some point you're going to lose somebody. At some point you're going to go through something that is a trial, whether it's big or small. So we're all going to face these things, but you know, just to this magnitude, I didn't expect it. I didn't see it coming. And I said, okay, well, we serve a God that is so good, because the doctors, scientifically, they cannot understand why I'm here. That's the God we serve. But that's big picture. Small picture, I just lost a whole semester of school. I'm not going to expect my parents to pay for another semester. We have a lease that's up in 2 weeks. How am I going to get my stuff? I have a wife I want to support. As a husband, you want to be a supporter. What am I going to do while I'm laying in a bed for the next 6 months? I am supposed to go to Guyana on a mission trip, and I've been preparing a 3-week preaching series for the last year, and that church has been waiting for me, and I'm going to totally let them down. And I'm just watching, like, okay, big picture, I'm alive, miracle. Small picture, my life is flipped upside down, and I have no control. And that's not God's fault. That's not God's concern. And my dad hands me my phone, and there's a voicemail from the dean of my school. And I don't know if you've ever tried to get grace or anything from a university or a college, but they're like, well, you had 3 sick days, so we'll see you next year. You can reapply. He said, look, Matt, we heard about your accident. We've been praying about it like crazy, and I don't know why, but we just want to, wherever your grades are, those are your final grades. Don't worry about finals. Congratulations. And my parents say, hey, guys, you know... my parents say, hey guys, you want to move in with us and we'll, you know, feed you, put a roof over your head and stay as long as you want and let us recover there for almost a year. And my in-laws and my wife, while I'm in the hospital, drive up to Tennessee, throw everything in a U-Haul, get it home. And then out of nowhere, last little problem I have, I can't control, my friend calls me and says, hey Matt, give me everything that you've been preparing. I'll fly to Guyana and preach for you. And it's just like, I think about how Paul says that God is made strong in his weakness. And I can't believe it because I am so weak. I've never been brought to this. I cannot stand. I remember just being so excited the first time I stood up and everything. And at that point, I learned that we serve a God that cares about the little things. And if you ask me, hey, I invented a time machine, let's go back, we can avoid that accident, that first accident, I'd say no. Because when I did recover from that, yes, I was 100%. I was back to me. You could barely see the scars. I had such good plastic surgeons. To this day, you couldn't even see that scar. But the relationship I built with God during that trial, when I learned all those things about the God we serve, if I would have known the storm that was coming, I'd never trade that. You know, that's what built what I could get through today. And these aren't tears of sadness. It's overwhelming joy for what he's done in my life. We fast forward a couple of years now, and you guys know Kyle. Kyle is, he can do anything. I mean, I wouldn't be surprised if you're like, hey, you got a $100 gift certificate to Lowe's, so he built this church for us. You know, Kyle is leading worship, preaching, building, awesome guy. And I think that's a little bit of why Kyle and I get along, because, you know, you need help with your car, I could fix cars. You need help with your house, and there's a church in Orlando, they needed their trees trimmed, and this is about 7 months ago. And I said, oh yeah, I could do that, no problem. And we rented a high reach from the company, and the company, I said, yeah, we're trimming these trees around the power lines. And they said, okay, send us a high reach. And they sent us a steel high reach instead of a fiberglass one. And as you saw in the video, I'm pretty far away from the power line. And next thing you know, I'm waking up from a coma. And I'm told they may be removing my arms tomorrow. And they can't believe that I'm even speaking, because they told my family, they said, you know, if he ever wakes up, you know, if he lives through this, they told my family and friends, he won't be the Matt, you know. He had 14,000 volts run through his body. He, it's the biggest power line they make. He is gonna be brain dead, and he's gonna have serious brain damage. We just don't know how serious. The electrocution melted all the skin off of my chest. So they said, he's gonna have heart damage. We're gonna put him on dialysis, not if, but when his kidneys fail, because it's gonna happen. And it's just like, you know, when's it stopping? And when I woke up, I can't explain it, but I was totally at peace. Like, I woke up and they're like, you were electrocuted, we might have to take your arms off. You don't have any skin on your chest, and about half of each of your arm is skinned, and the infection rate's like 70%, because it's not third degree burn where the skin is damaged, but there's no more skin. It melted away at fourth and fifth degree. So the infection rate, you know, it could be, if you start going downhill, it's gonna be 24 hours and it could go to your heart. So that first month was really scary. But I can't explain it. I just kind of had a peace about it. I just was like, okay, God, I may not have tomorrow, but I have today. You know, thank you so much for today. Thank you for the life you've given me. Thank you that my wife is pregnant, and at least if I'm not here, my son will be. And I can't explain how calm and peaceful I felt in the midst of the biggest storm I've ever faced. And I just thank God for that. He's just incredible. And let's give God a round of applause. You know, and as we talk about these trials we go through, you know, some of you may have gone through trials like I have. You may have, maybe you lost your brother, you lost your daughter, or your son, and it's hard. I know it's hard. But we need to think, okay, how do we get through these daily? Well, I don't know, what helped me was, first of all, thinking big picture. I think mindset is everything, and thinking, okay, big picture, this is 50 years. Like, this is 50 more years, 100 years max, whatever we have on this earth. Okay, so for 100 years, we're gonna struggle. And then we have billions of billions of billions of years to live in perfect angelic bodies with our Savior and Creator of the universe. Like, can we comprehend that? Like, 100 bricks would maybe reach the length of this building, and we're gonna have enough bricks to go around the world a million times. Like, that's the amount of time we have with our Savior. So when we grasp that big picture, things like this, things like getting electrocuted, things like losing your legs or losing a loved one or losing a pet or a wife or a husband, you break up, it's hard. I'm not saying it's not. But we could get through it with Christ, and he's overcome this world, just like Kyle said. We just had, talk about babies, we just had our first baby. Little Justice is his first time at church. He's over there. He's 3 weeks old, and when I look at Justice, he has this thing where when we talk about, okay, earth-shattering tragedies, when you take the binky out of his mouth, the world just ended. I mean, he loses all composure, all control, and he cannot handle, to him, the binky's gone, it's never coming back, and it's over. My life is over. That's Justice's mind, and we as adults can look at that and laugh and say, Justice, we overcame the binky. It's right here, and we could put it right back in. And then we get a little older and we become teenagers and we have our first girlfriend or boyfriend. You guys remember that? Your first girlfriend or boyfriend, and oh my goodness, Mom, Dad, she's the one, and she's the best, and it's everything, and you don't even know. It's like, this is it. And then a couple months later, you break up, and your world ended. I'm never getting through this. Why am I even here? And the parents look at you like, it's okay. You're gonna get through this. And that one lasts a little longer than the binky, could be a few months, but then you meet someone else, and you're like, this is so much better than the last one. But for some reason, when we become adults, we don't think that we still do that. We have a tragedy, and we still act like that. We still go, oh my gosh, I lost my cousin. I lost my dog. I'm in a wheelchair. It's over. And God is looking at us like, guy, I overcame the binky. You only got like 20 years in the wheelchair, and then you got forever. And we lose perspective of that. So if we could just grasp that picture, that puts us in a mindset to where, like Kyle said, bring it on. We can get through anything. We're coming through this. And I don't want to act like the battle's not there, because that big picture, yeah, that will get you through the tragedy as a whole. But how do you get through today? You know, as a smoker, you could see big picture the benefits of getting away, or as an alcoholic of getting away, but how do you not walk up to the cabinet today and pick up that drink? How do you not go to the gas station and have that cigarette? And I say, just take it day by day. I'll never forget, there was this 3-week span in the hospital. I was in the hospital for a few months, and you know, I had, over the past 7 months, I've had 13 surgeries now, and I've got more coming up. But there was this 3-week span that was the hardest of it all. It was in the heart of the battle, and it was like I'd wake up and like, you got surgery today, and then this test tomorrow, and then we're moving this tomorrow, and then the next day you got another surgery, and I had like 4 surgeries in 2 weeks, and it just seemed like I knew tomorrow was going to be more painful than today, and today was, if my limit's here of pain, this is today. So if I tried to think about tomorrow, I couldn't get there. If I had to think about later on that day, I couldn't get there. So what I had to do was say, okay, big picture, I'm in a positive mindset. However this ends up, God's taking care of it. But right now, they're about to take this dressing off my legs, and it's stuck, and I don't have any skin on my legs, and it is going to be the worst thing I can imagine. But I'm just going to get through the next 20 minutes. I'm going to look at the clock, I'm going to get through the next 20 minutes, and I'm going to get through today. And that's what we have to do. We have to wake up and say, you know, I can't overcome being an alcoholic, but I can not have a drink till noon. And then at noon, you know what, I'm not going to have a drink till dinner. And okay, I'm not going to, and just keep getting through that day. However small you need to make the increments, just make those goals. They kept saying, what is your goal? I said, I just want to hold my son. I'm going to get through this hospital and I'm going to hold my son. And they said, you're going to be here a year. I said, no, I'm going to get out by the time he's born. I don't care what you say. If I get out and I hold him and then a week later I got surgery, I got to go back in, that's okay. But I'm going to be out to hold him. And I got out in September. And he was born 2 weeks ago, and it's just been a miracle every step of the way. And when I think of the God we serve, you know, we say, well, why did he allow those things to happen to Job? Why did he allow you to be electrocuted? Well, first off, he's not going to mess with free will. That's what the plan of salvation is. You know, if I'm going to go walk into something that's going to hurt me, he can foresee that, and he can try to send little things that try to help me. That first accident I had, my dad called me. I'll never forget that phone call. He called me and said, Matt, you got finals tomorrow or on Monday. What are you doing? You've got the rest of your life to wake skate. Why don't you just skip this contest? But if, what is God going to do? Is he going to stop me? Is he going to change my mind and mess with my decision making, which he promised he hasn't done, which is why he had to die so we can make a choice? He's not going to do that, but he can see a bad situation and say, that's terrible, but I'm going to work in it. I'm going to work through this. And, you know, that's how it is. I look at both accidents. There were signs. You know, looking back, there were things that could have kept me away from that. But God just saw what was coming, and maybe that's why he blessed me so much through that first one, because he could see the storm coming, and he said, I got to build this guy's faith. I got to build this because, you know, he's got a heart for me, but is it strong enough? And I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for both of them. It's why I'm here today. It's made me who I am. And as hard as it is, I'm not sugarcoating it. Right now, I live every day in pain. There's not a day that I'm not hurting. And I usually don't, you know, I don't go around telling my friends, I don't go around telling people that because I don't want sympathy or anything. But, you know, when we're talking about struggle and perseverance, we don't need to candy coat it. We could all be family here and we could say, you know what? Today sucked. You know, today I woke up and I couldn't get out of bed because the nerve pain was so bad. But like I said, we're going to get through today and this too shall pass. And I just think about, you know, from a fatherly perspective, I just became a father and I look at my son and I don't want anything to hurt him. And I look at my dad and how hard it probably was for him to watch me go through that. It kills him, it, you know. But I think about how much harder it would have been if he saw a bunch of people drag me to Orlando, put me in display in front of the whole city, beat me to where I couldn't even stand up and nail my hands and do a cross and hang me there and let everybody watch as I die. What does that look like for God as a father to do for no other reason other than because he is crazy about you and he loves you? So, you know what? Do we serve an unfair God? Well, statistically and scientifically, and what the doctors tell me, my first accident should have killed me. Statistically, my second accident should have definitely killed me. Statistically, I shouldn't have arms. I shouldn't have my own heart. I shouldn't have my organs. I should not be here. So if we served a fair God, that's where I would be. I would not be standing up here. But we serve an unfair God that's crazy about you. And every once in a while, he just steps up and he watches the trial you're going through and he just tilts the odds a little bit and just to remind Satan a little bit, to remind us a little bit, I'm still here. We're coming through this. You're coming home one day. I'm still in control. And he does that, and it blows our minds. And I don't know, it's just amazing. So I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what you're going to go through, but I can promise you we're going to go through stuff. But come to your church family, come to your real family, come to your husband, your wife, whoever it is, because you're going to get through this and just get through today. And remember the God we serve that has the promise of eternity. I just want to bow our heads really quick for a prayer and just say thank you. Lord, I don't know what your plans are for this church, for this congregation. I pray over each person in this church. I thank you so much that they're here. They're here to serve you. They're here to learn more about you. And I just lift their hearts to you, Lord. Fill them with your Holy Spirit. And whatever they're going through, just remind them. Just tilt those odds and say, look, I'm crazy about you, and this too shall pass. You know, they meant it for evil to harm you, but I can do good with it. I can bless it and blow your mind. Lord, I thank you for the opportunity to just come here and to have the freedom of worship and the freedom that we have in this country to be able to do this. And I just pray over everybody as they go home tonight that your word and your message rings true to our hearts. We don't walk out of here and forget it, but it's instilled and it's imprinted in our hearts that we didn't hear Kyle up here today, we didn't hear me, but we heard you speak through us, that we're just a voice. In your name we pray, amen.
Yeah, let's give it up for God, what he's doing in this man's life.
So for those of you who don't know, Jamie and I are moving to Colorado on Monday. So this could very well be the last song that we get to play at Revolution Church. So this song is actually the song from which our band got the name, With Everything. So what it says is to sing with everything, so to give him everything. So I just want to invite you guys to just give it everything you've got. John's got some.
Something?
Nope.
Can
go ahead.
Something?
Yeah.
Listen, man. God forgive me, you guys forgive me, because when I was asked to come up here and give an explanation on what's going to happen on Friday night at this place, that was creepy. That was terrible. And that was the enemy working on me that throws me up on here. I'm going to tell you something. We're about to start something here that people are even talking about.
Amen.
Play this day, find Moses, and things are going to happen. I can't give you exact details of what's happening, but I know it's going to be huge. Yeah. If you want to be a part of it, Friday night, you're wearing that.
Let's just come to our feet and worship one last time.
our hearts they cry, we glorify, we lift it high above all names. For you are King with everything, we will shout for your
Father God, I just thank you for everything that you've done, Lord. Lord, these past 4.5 years have just absolutely been amazing, Lord. You've changed my life. You've brought me an incredible wife, Lord, an incredible church family. Lord, you've drawn even my blood family together, Lord, closer together, Lord, in you. It's in you that we unite, Lord. Lord God, you're awesome. Lord, I pray that you would stay right here with this church, Lord, that you would never depart from this church, Father. Lord, that you would just lift this ministry for your glory, Lord. That you would use every single person in here, Lord, to draw more near to you, Lord. Like my brother John said, Lord, we've only got 100 years to save as many people as we can. It's you and us versus the enemy, Lord. It's never you and us versus the other people. So, Father, I just pray that you would use this church, Lord, to overcome. Father God, give us a heart of perseverance that doesn't even have the word quit in our vocabulary, Lord. That when the enemy is tempting us, when he's getting in our way, Lord, that we don't even have the option to quit, Lord, because your spirit is so strong in us, Lord, that we can't help but to go on, Lord. Lord God, we have no choice. So Lord, I just pray your great blessing over this church. I thank you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you guys.